Hey guys, in this video, I'm going to show you how to deploy a production-grade database cluster in Kubernetes. I'm going to be using MySQL, but the concepts you learn here can be used to deploy any other database. If you're new to this channel, please hit the subscribe button. I release new DevOps and reliability videos every week, and your support would be extremely helpful. And now, let's get started. This is the architecture of the MySQL cluster we'll deploy. The writer node handles all the writes. All data gets replicated to three other readers. All read requests are sent to these readers. This way, we're able to scale for both writes and reads. Here's the main tutorial from Kubernetes documentation that I'm going to be following. The link for this tutorial is in the description below. I've also included links to all relevant Kubernetes concepts and my GitHub repository that contains the code used here. These are a few basic Kubernetes concepts I'm assuming you already know. It is also a plus if you have some familiarity with MySQL, but this is not mandatory. Now, let's learn a few advanced Kubernetes concepts that will help us achieve our database setup. A persistent volume is a piece of storage in the cluster. A pod can use it to persist data. Even when you restart or delete the pod, the PV doesn't get deleted because it has an independent lifecycle. So it is the ideal place for you to store data that you don't want to lose. A PV abstracts away the underlying storage mechanism from the user. An administrator could be using anything like a network file system, Ceph, AWS EBS, or even local hard disk underneath. When an administrator manually provisions a PV for you to use, it's called static provisioning. Dynamic provisioning is when Kubernetes creates a PV on demand. Here's an example configuration of a statically provisioned persistent volume. A persistent volume claim is a request for storage by a user. When you create a pod, it consumes some node resources like CPU. Similarly, when you create a PVC, it consumes a persistent volume. PVC is where you specify things like the disk size that you need, access mode like read-only or read-write, etc. Your claim might end up getting bound to a PV that was statically provisioned or dynamically, whatever satisfies the criteria specified. A stateful set is for stateful applications what a deployment is for normal stateless applications. It too manages pods based on a container specification. So when you want to use storage volumes in your pod, you deploy it using stateful set. It ensures that pods are always mapped to the same persistent volume they were originally given. Every Kubernetes service performs load balancing of requests. If I perform a DNS lookup, the service returns its cluster IP. So my request gets forwarded to one of the pods. This is great for the usual stateless services, but it's not desirable in our case because what if a write request ends up going to a reader or vice versa? This means I directly want the IP of the writer pod. So how do we achieve this? We use the concept of headless service. When you declare a service to be headless, performing a DNS lookup doesn't return the cluster IP. Instead, it returns IPs of all the pods behind it. The service creates DNS entries for each pod. We use this method to specifically reach the writer pod for all our writes. We can declare a service headless by simply setting cluster IP to none in the definition. Let's have a look at the setup now. For this video, I'm running Minikube on a Linux virtual machine. I gave it 8 GB of memory and 50 GB of disk space. My cluster has one control plane and two worker nodes, all simulated inside the VM. Of course, in a production setup, you'd have a real Kubernetes cluster with multiple servers and better configurations. I've enabled dynamic provisioning of persistent volumes, so when I run the database pods, my cluster automatically gives them new storage. I'm using local disk for these storage volumes. I've included the link on how to do this in the description, but your configurations and drivers might be different from mine. Here are the configurations I'm going to apply for the MySQL cluster. The code is slightly modified from the tutorial and also available in my GitHub repository. The config map YAML lets us control configurations for the MySQL writer and readers. For example, we want the readers to reject any writes that don't come via writer replication log. We configure in the stateful set whether a pod is a writer or a reader, and based on that, the pod picks up the write configuration from here. Up next, we declare two services. The first is a headless MySQL service so we can access the writer endpoint. The second is a normal service that load balances our read requests amongst all MySQL pods. Finally, here's the stateful set that launches the pods. A stateful set controller creates its pods one at a time in order of the pod index. It also gives them stable DNS names like MySQL 0, MySQL 1, and so on. We'll see this in action soon. The init MySQL container creates custom configuration for each MySQL pod. It generates a unique server ID based on pod index. If the index is 0, it applies the writer configuration, else it simply applies the reader configuration. When the service brings up a new pod, the clone MySQL container copies data from an already existing pod into it, so it doesn't have to replicate from scratch. This cloning is skipped if we're bringing up a writer pod. We define the MySQL container and specify things like config paths, resources to allocate, health checks, etc. Extra backup is a sidecar container that starts the replication in all readers. At the bottom is our configuration for persistent volume claim. This tells Kubernetes to give a 5GB storage volume that satisfies all the criteria here to all our pods. Let's apply the configurations. Config maps. Services, stateful sets, and let's watch the progress. It creates one pod at a time. Notice the index. 0 is the writer, rest are all readers. So the MySQL cluster is now running. MySQL 0 is the writer, the rest are readers. Let's check the persistent volumes and claims that each pod received. Each got a 5GB storage volume. Let's now send some traffic to our database. First, I'm going to send a query to the writer. I'm running a temporary MySQL client that sends a query to create a database and table and insert a row. Now let's run a read query to get our row back. This time, we send our request to the reader pool and the service forwards it to one of the replicas. Perfect. We were able to fetch the data. Currently, we have two readers. Let's add more replicas to scale out our read traffic. After a while, two new pods have been spun up. Stateful Set also recreates a pod that crashes or gets deleted. It ensures that the new pod is linked to the same persistent volume claim that was given to the original one. Let's see this in action. I have 5 pods with me, so how about I delete one? And let's watch the progress. As you can see, a replacement was spun up. So we have resilience built into our application. Perfect. That's all, folks. These are the basics of how you can deploy databases to Kubernetes in production. Depending on your specific use case, there can be a lot more configurations involved. So make sure you know beforehand what you're signing up for. If you found this video insightful, please like and share. And if you want to stay on top of the world of DevOps and SRE, hit the subscribe button. Cheers.